The first important choice of my life almost killed me. I was a little two-year-old boy sitting on the back seat of a car next to my brother Jaume, who was four. My father was driving in the streets of Madrid. I was getting bored. It was so hot. I needed fresh air. And then suddenly I had this clever idea, this vision. What if I open the door? Well, I did it, and I fell off, and the door closed behind me. What is this noise? My father said. Mikael jumped off. My brother said, no, this is not possible. Look under the seat. He's probably hiding there. My brother, who had seen me fall, looked under the seat and said, he's not there. He jumped off. You know how curiosity killed the cat? Well, this time the cat did not die because I breathe. But the little cat I was spent 2 months in hospital suffering like hell. Soon after this accident, I start thinking about big decisions. But what about yours? What is the big decisions you've made so far? Think of them. There are probably not so many, a handful of them. Think of one big decision you made recently. How did you make up your mind? What feelings, what thoughts, what values motivated your choice? Maybe you thought about God or fate? Are you thinking about your big decisions? Another important decision I made, the first important decision I made as an adult, was moving into Paris, the city of lights and love. I was in the United States in some Olympic Games of mathematics, representing Spain. In the ceremony, President Bush came. He gave us advice about trigonometrics and triangles. Then came Andrew Wiles, a man who just solved the 350-year-old conjecture from Fermat. He just received a few medals. I was so impressed. After the ceremony, I went to have some pizza, and then a guy came and said, oh, you are from Barcelona. You should go to Paris. You should study in the École Normale Supérieure. This is the best place in the world to study mathematics. That was awesome. Imagine, you are 17 years old, and you hear the best place in the world and Paris. Ooh la la, Paris. It sounded like a fairy tale, and today it is my hometown. The second important decision I made came 1 year later. It was embracing my other passion, theater. I have been combining professional theater and mathematics for nearly 10 years. Maybe you wonder, theater and mathematics, what do they have in common? Can anyone tell? Oh, there is one thing in common. There is a branch in mathematics called game theory. Game theory studies games. Not games like chess or poker. Any human interaction is a game. Game theory, like theater, is concerned about big decisions. Actors and mathematicians, we both work in understanding the big game of life. So how do we make a great decision? These choices, we feel we are about to cross a line. Change countries. Marry someone. Have a child. Okay, when? Where? Change a job. Choose your career. Understanding how to decide and how to decide well is one of the biggest mysteries of humanity. Since the beginning of times, religion, philosophy, the arts and sciences try to answer to that question. Is there an answer? How did Jesus decide to turn the other cheek instead of punching the guy in the nose? How did Fred Astaire decide dancing cheek to cheek instead of chin to chin? How did Hamlet decide to be instead of not to be? How did President Truman decide to drop a nuclear bomb on Hiroshima instead of dropping millions of flowers. Today, I propose three extreme methods for making great decisions. We have to think of them as three vertices of a triangle. We all live inside of this triangle. Understanding how these extreme points work will tell us how to make a great decision in the future. The first method, it's the Robert De Niro method. The second method, it's the game theorist method. And the third method is the Gabriel Garcia Marquez method. Okay, imagine yourself as the captain of a sailing boat. You feel the ocean under the boat. Ah, you breathe. You feel this, the sea. Ah, the fresh air on your face. You are like Robert De Niro. But you are also measuring the wind, measuring your direction, playing with the elements, choosing the right path, avoiding risks. You are a game theorist. Or maybe you are dreaming about places nobody has seen before. You are like Gabriel Garcia Marquez. Let's start with this Robert De Niro method. What is it about? It's about letting your body decide for you. Listening to your body. No thinking. Imagine Robert De Niro in the shooting of Taxi Driver. Imagine his body. How he breathes. He knows the whole script. He knows his partners. His lines are like his thoughts. Scorsese tells him something. His reaction is instantaneous. It's like lightning. It's always great. Are you talking to me? Are you talking to me? Are you talking to me? Who the hell are you talking to? Well, I'm the only one here. No past, no future, no family problems. He lives in the present, within the present, like an enlightened Buddha. Actors are not the only ones who master this method. Also sportsmen. Think of Lionel Messi, Michael Jordan, when they get the ball. They already know where all the other people are. They know what to do. When to dribble. Pass, shoot, pass, 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 shoot, smash. Nobody can stop them. They do it again and again and again and again. It looks so easy. That's where the paradox lies. The Robert De Niro method is all about training. Training your mind and your body to grasp the present so that when you make a decision, it is a great decision. So that your impulses are great decisions. You may ask me, well, yeah, okay, but how do we train this? Let's make a little exercise. Hello? So please stand up, everybody. Give your hands to your neighbors. Ah, you have to touch other people, people you don't know. Try to feel the heat of this hand. Is it wet? Is it dry? Is it smooth? Now close your eyes. Try to feel again this hand. Now imagine that the hand you're holding weighs 5 kilos. Imagination is like a muscle. If you don't train it, it may die forever. Let's breathe together. Now imagine you are not alone. You are part of a crowd of 1,000 people holding hands. What does that change? Breathe again. Open your eyes. Look at your neighbors. Look at the other people. Feel if something has changed. Release the hands. Now, when you will sit, don't think you're gonna sit on the chair. Sit, you're gonna sit in the center of the universe. Let's sit down. I'm not sure everyone felt he was sitting in the center of the universe. In real life, we seldom pay attention to our bodies or other people's bodies. Yet, you just experience how this attention makes the whole difference in the way You feel the world. In real life, we take objects without even thinking how they're made, what they are. We think about ourselves, but we never think about the space around us. Robert De Niro does. He always knows where and how his body's standing in the universe. Well, maybe not when he's drunk or asleep, but at least when he's acting. Wow, this method is awesome, but beware of using it without training, because you can end up falling off a car. Let's move to this other method, the game theories method. What is it about? It's about rationality. It is about measuring things. For example, what is the first thing you do with a newborn in a French hospital? You remove it from the parents and you do the Apgar test. The Apgar test is that you're gonna rate the baby, 0, 1, or 2, at 5 different criteria, like the skin color, the pulse rate, or the reflex irritability grimace. You bother the baby and you measure how much he's bothered. These 5 numbers determine how well your baby is. Big numbers, good baby. Bad numbers, bad baby. But the magic with numbers is that you can add them up. So let's add them up. Now you have a score, the Apgar score, a number between 0 and 10. Now you can decide very easily of a decision rule. Big, low score, baby in danger, emergency room. Big score, save baby, go back to your parents. This kind of method has saved millions of lives. The whole point is about you have a very hard real-life problem, you define a measure which transforms it into a single number, and then some decision rule which takes this number into one action. This is the method that almost all the professions prefer. How elegant, how easy. Politicians, government agencies, businessmen, they adore this method. Generally, one's decision depend on other people's decisions. The game theorist method should ask, well, okay, who else is deciding here? Who they are? What information they have? What do they know about who I am? Can I measure something? Here, for instance, in the audience, there are probably about 10 young men, 10 young women, who would like to get married soon. Maybe some of them are single now. Let's not wait. Let's make the wedding happen now. How do we do? Okay? We cannot just make like 10 random matchings. What could happen? It could happen there are 2 couples. He loves she and she loves he. What a tragedy. Infidelity, drama, and a tragic, tragic end. Game theories have a solution. Each girl should rank the boys. What is the best boy? What is the second best, the third, the 10th? The boys should do the same and give these rankings to a game theorist. The game theorist will use the Hungarian method, some kind of algorithm, trying all these couples. And then, bum, bum, ba, bum, 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 ba, bum, 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 ba, bum, bum, ba, bum, bum, ba, bum, you are sure to make 10 happy and stable marriages. Of course, this is a metaphor. Nobody gets married using the Hungarian method. But this method is used to match students and universities, doctors and hospitals, livers and liver donators, users and servers, buyers and sellers. The guy who invented this is a game theorist, and he received a Nobel Prize for it 3 years ago. So now, what do you think about this method? It looks so nice, but beware of numbers. Using this method without being critical and aware about where these measures come from can lead to disastrous decisions. And now I conclude by talking about this other method, the Gabriel Garcia Marquez method. What would Gabriel Garcia Marquez do if he had to make a great decision? He'd write a novel. He'd think of the characters. What are their frustrations? What are their dreams? What are their values? Are they driven by jealousy or by love, by friendship or by anger? He'd think of a place where the action happens. He'd think of possible plots, and among all these possibilities, he'd choose one, the one that he likes, the one that he prefers because it's more exciting, it's more meaningful, more poetical. The Gabriel Garcia method is about creative writing. It's not about measuring things. It's about measuring souls. What is the story that my decision is telling? Or better, what is the story that I would like my decision to tell? A story you believe in. A story that makes you live better. Stories are very powerful. But beware of using stories. They are also a very powerful tool to manipulate the opinions, especially when they are combined with numbers. So now we arrive at the end. How to make a great decision? I have been thinking for more than 10 years, for all my life, about this question, be it as an actor or as a game theorist, as a teacher or as a father, as a lover, as a friend, as a citizen of the world. If there was an answer, believe me, I would tell it to you. But there isn't. Nobody can tell you how you should decide. There is no impulse, no number, no story that can decide if it does not come from you. Your choices define who you are. They are your responsibility. They are the trace of your existence. You are the Robert De Niro of your life. You are the game theorist of your mind, and you are the Gabriel Garcia Marquez of your dreams. Listen to them, they whisper things, and don't let anyone else tell you what to do or think or feel. Your choices belong to you. You have the last word. Thank you very much.